the first thing we do, it's start outside the bus, and we want to make sure that the sides of the bus the front of the bus the other side of this bus that there's nothing out of the ordinary. The first thing you can catch is maybe that the bus is kneeling to the side. You can see some damage, something broken. So the first thing you do on your pre-trip inspection is to see for anything out of the ordinary. Let's move on to the next section. Okay, so after doing that inspection on the front for checking out of the anything out of the ordinary, I come to the main entrance door. Want to make sure the main entrance door opens and closes freely. I check the seals on the door for any damage, any cracks. I check the windows, make sure they're clean and free of any cracks. I check the step well, make sure there's no tripping hazards, it's clean, and it has a label which specifies, watch your step. I have my handlebars, which are secure. And there's a handheld stop sign. It is legible, clean, no damage on it, in operable conditions. My modesty panel is secure, in good condition. And then I would like to invite my cameraman inside the bus. Come in. I call him my cameraman, but it's my cell phone man. All right, on this side, I have a headboard, which is part of the exit, and it's secure in place. I follow the instructions for the immediate first emergency exit. It is labeled emergency release to the right. This becomes my first emergency exit, and it works properly. From that point, I go into my emergency equipment, first aid kit, reflectors, and fire extinguisher. On the first aid kit, I know this bus is for 78 passengers, so I open my first aid kit. First thing I check is the weather seal. Make sure it's intact, not cracked or damaged. It's meant to keep moisture and dust out. Then I have a list of required units, taped and labeled. And I must have no less than 24 units because of the passenger capacity on this bus. I count them, 6, 8, 9, 10, 14, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. Or 24 are there. A new requirement when you go to CHP is to now check that you have the proper units and contents. So I got everything highlighted of what I need to have on this first aid kit. I got all the 1-inch compress, 2-inch compress, 3-inch compress, 4-inch compress, 1 iPad, 1 3x3 gauze, 2 2x6 gauzes, 1, 2, 3, 4 of the 18x36 compresses, 1, 2, 3, 4 of the compress bandage, 4 triangular bandages, 1 forceps scissors. It's a requirement. You can find that on your 82.7. This first aid kit is up to standard. Now, I will check my my fire extinguisher. It is secure in place. Unlatch it. On the fire extinguisher, everything's important on this bus, but this is important too. I check the cylinder itself, has no damage, no rust, no cracks. The hose is secure to the stem. There's no cracks on it. The pin is secure. The seal is not broken. It is fully charged on green, and it was last inspected on June 1st, 2017. Inspections are done on a yearly basis. Now, it is set for 3 types of fire. It gives you instructions how to operate it, and it's rated at 40 BC. Minimum required on the school bus, no less than 8 BC. In case of a fire, I will pull the pin, aim at the bottom of the fire, squeeze the trigger, and sweep side to side, again, at the base of the fire. Put this back. And just bear with me, but I'll get it all done. Next, reflector box. Secure in place, 1, 2, 3. I got 3 reflectors. I have a system where I check a different reflector every day. Set it up, very simple. That's how you set it up. Check the reflectors, they're all in working condition, no damage, no cracks. The sand tube, it has no leaks. You're required to do this for CHP. Renewing, original, you're required to do this. I come into documentation, but since a lot of these documents belong to this district and they're not mine, I'm just gonna tell you what I check. I check registration, insurance, CHP 292, I match them. And I wanna make sure that those documents match my bus's plate information. Wanna make sure that these 3 documents are up to date. On the CHP 292, I wanna make sure what it's certifying. So it's certifying a school bus. It's a 2017 Bluebird Bus 1 owned by my district. And it's set for 78 passengers. It was last inspected on July 6, 2017. We have 13 months. Next inspection on this bus must be done no later than August 6, 2018. So that's set for the emergency equipment documentation. I want to make sure before I get into that seat that I check my mirrors, fans, visors, steering wheel, seat, brackets, to make sure that everything's secure in place. Alrighty. Since this is a type 1 bus, our requirement for a type 1 bus is for the seat to be adjustable down, up, forwards, backwards, and lock in place. From this point now, I check my seatbelt for any freight, any damage, and to make sure that it actually locks in place properly so it does click. I give it a pull, it's working properly. At this time now, I'm gonna check that all my mirrors are properly adjusted. I can reach my steering wheel comfortably. I can reach both my throttle and my accelerator comfortably. I start with my cross view mirrors. They're adjusted so I can see the front of the bus, the sides of the bus, which are immediate danger zones. I have a left flat and a right flat convex mirrors. They're not required. I have a left flat and a right flat mirror. They're required. They're adjusted so I can see 1 inch of the bus on each side, 200 feet to the rear on each side, and the rear tires touching the ground on each side. Lastly, I have my inside overhead mirror. It is adjusted so I can see all of the emergency exits and the students sitting behind me. All right, I'm done with this section. Next is gonna be the instrument panel, controls and lights. The first 2 switches I have here are for the front and rear passenger sections. They're all lights. They go on. Quickly check my mirror. All my lights inside work. Come back, turn them off. I have a strobe light switch here, and I'll turn it on. Indicator light came on. I will check that on my walk around when I do my 3rd walk around. That's the way I have it. The indicator says that it does work. My noise suppressant, very important switch, very important. And this is simple to check, very simple. I'm gonna turn my radio on, okay? Noise suppressant goes on, radio went off. If I have my AC on, AC will go off. This is something that I use when I'm at railroad tracks, right before I do the railroad check. Very helpful switch. Let me cancel it. All right. This is the entry light. Switch on. Entry lights are working like they're supposed to. I have my front hand fans here, switches. they're working like they're supposed to. And of course I check them on high. Oh yes, feels nice and cool. Turn them off. High idle switch, very important switch. Sometimes you need to do a little bit of high idle to make your governor in your air brake system kick in faster and cut out faster. Sometimes when you have your air conditioning on and you're at idle, park somewhere, and you need to high idle that engine to keep that battery charged. So this is how you test it. Switch goes on. And you can see that my needle for my tachometer, it's going up. That's a good test. And I can hear the engine ramming. I just canceled it. High idle switch, very important. My God, you're gonna hear me say a lot, very important. Everything's important on the school bus, everything. This is for my headlight system. Right now, on this particular system, setup is off. If I go just halfway, one click, my park lights will come on. And it's gonna be hard for you to see that. Maybe in the cross view mirror, I don't know if you can see my clearance lights came out on the side. And then headlights. My headlights are on. I can see them again on my cross view mirror. And if I go on the other cross view mirror, they're on. And from this point, I leave that switch on. The cluster, the famous cluster. So again, I always have a sequence of how to start my inspection. And I have the park light on, the parking light on, very important because my park brake is set. Then I have my speedometer. And I know that from history, let me go to the right angle, that it does work and it's at zero right now. Next gauge. This is my radiator temperature. Right now it's a good range. Okay. We want to see it between 3/4, half to 1/4. That's a good range on the radiator temperature. We don't want to see it up here. That's dangerous. If it's going up there, you need to pull over somewhere, let that engine cool down. That's dangerous. And if it stays up there all the time, then that bus is just out of service. It's not working. Up here, the famous dual air brake gauges. My friends, this is simple. When you see an R, that means rear. When you see an F, that means front. Okay? This gauge reading for my air system is reading the front system. This is the rear system. My primary system, my secondary system, and they're both reading right now at 120 PSI. Usually, the most accurate gauge needle will be the primary system gauge. That's just an FYI for you. Then I have my fuel gauge. Shows 3/4 of a tank, and this is diesel on this bus. And I'm gonna go over here first to the tachometer. Very easy, think of tacos. Tacos, tachometer. And right now, it reads that my bus is idling at 800 RPMs, 8 times 100. Okay, very important to know. And this means revolutions per minute, the times the engine's turning per minute, revolutions per minute. On the bottom over here, I got a super important gauge. That's the engine oil pressure gauge. And this is how I test it. Right now, it's reading at about 25, 26 PSI. Yes, PSI, pounds per square inch. It's pressure that you're checking. I'm gonna throttle the system, check it out. I am gonna throttle the system. I'm throttling the system, engine pressure's going up. That's very important. You wanna see engine pressure go up, okay? Okay, let's continue with part two of the inspection of the gauges, controls, and lights. I do apologize. yesterday my phone died, but this time I'm ready. And I left off where it says death level at 50%. That's that other fuel the bus uses. And the mechanics in our shop are the only ones that have access to this. They just advise me that anything above 35% to let them know, and they take care of filling that up. Let's go into the voltage. Okay, this is the voltage. Battery voltage. If I didn't say it on the other video, I'll say it right now. Battery charge between 12 and 16 volts, it's good. Amperage, it's on the positive side. That's a good signal. Transmission oil temperature. Okay, right now it's at 122. Anything below 250 Fahrenheit, it's good. I went over this already, the whole explanation on the engine oil pressure. I went over the gears. I said, this is neutral right now. You got reverse, neutral, and drive, upshift, downshift within five gears. And I'm gonna come over here to the heating system. This is the driver's high, low, off. Passenger high, low, and I can hear the fans going at the heat pump. That heat pump indicator goes on, off. It just makes the heating system go work faster. I believe on this bus, sends hot air to the front and hot air to the rear. Hot water, and that makes the heating system work faster. My air conditioning system. This is the thermostat control for my air conditioning system. It's in good condition. The AC has three controls. 1, 2, 3. That feels really, really good. It works all three levels. I have my door control. Service door. I open the door. The door opens and I check my entry light. And it works. I will close the door. And it closes like it's supposed to. This is my 8 light system. Ambers and reds. So the master goes on. My amber lights, the indicators indicate they're working. Red lights go on. Indicator says they're working. Cancel that. I go down. And that's not required on your school bus. If you have that, it's good. Keep you happy when you're driving. Music. Then I have an exterior PA. Which I check it, the light, it works. And I have my two-way, which I check every day. I'm gonna lower the volume just in case somebody calls me right now. And I got two vent knobs here, outside, inside, circulation. This one's on neutral right now, but I can set it for defroster or driver. I'm gonna put it on defroster section, thermostat for my defroster, and on defroster level, 1, 2, 3. I gotta make sure that I feel all that air coming up in the windshield, and it works. I go down to my I'm gonna call it accelerator, but we call it a throttle. Service brake pedal. They're in good condition. There's nothing in the back that would impede the proper use of them. I got my air horn, and I come up the steering column, check the steering wheel for play. There is good play on my steering wheel. And it also has tilt and telescoping, but that's not required to be checked. My left turn signal indicator works. My right turn signal indicator works. High beam indicator works. Hazard lights indicators work. I'm gonna check my wipers on three levels. 2, 3, and washer fluid. Washer fluid has to work. That's it, all the way up. So that's part of the inspection of the instrument panel, gauges, controls, and lights in this bus. Okay, now we're gonna do the inspection of the passenger compartment. On this bus, we have seat belts. And since we have seat belts, we have to also inspect them.
there's a way that I do this, and just follow along with me, and it's very simple to get through all of it. All right, so I start from the top. I just visually see the rivets, panels, speakers, light caps. Make sure that everything's not falling. I can visually see nothing's falling. I come to the first set of seat belts on the right, and I check a set of seat belts. Since I'm recording with one hand, and with the other hand I'm trying to do the job of clicking this seat belt, just bear with me. There it is. The seat belt system works properly. And I'll check a window. I'll open it all the way down, slide it down, and close it back up. So I check a window and a seat belt system on each side. I'll do the same for this. I'll click, unclick, open the window, slide it down, slide it up, and eventually throughout the week, I'll get through all the seatbelt systems and all the windows. Make sure that the windows operate properly for regular ventilation. On this bus, I am so lucky to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 emergency exits. And they're all labeled with instructions to operate them. And in this bus, all of my emergency exits have devices that activate at the driver's compartment, which is a light indicator and buzzer. When you operate these emergency exits, all those devices must work if they are in the bus. So for example, this roof emergency exit, it is labeled emergency exit and it has instructions. Turn then push knob to open. Very simple, turn, push. Okay, so it does work. Very simple. I come to the driver's compartment. I can see the light on. Oh, and that's loud. That's a good test. That's a good inspection. I'm back. And I put the roof hatch back and locked it in place. I check my main aisle. Make sure it's not blocked with anything. No tripping hazards. Okay. And like I said, every emergency exit, you must operate. It has instructions, it has operating instructions, and it's labeled. Very simple, rotate up, open window all the way out, close it. I have another emergency exit over here, and I will do the same thing. Follow the instructions and operate it and check my devices. On this bus, I have a side emergency exit with instructions. Do not block, emergency exit. See instructions below. Everything's labeled like it should be. There's a headboard. Make sure it's secure in place, not loose. Then I go down and follow the instructions. Pull up, push out. Go check my devices at the driver's compartment. Come back, close it. And as I'm pulling away from this emergency section, I have an emergency seat. I want to make sure that the seat folds down properly and that it pivots back up properly. That's a requirement now that the CHP testing officer is looking for. Take note on that. And you will follow the same instructions on how to operate this emergency exit. Operate it, go check your devices on the rear. It is also labeled emergency exit. It says do not block and follow the instructions with the arrow. Pull up, open it up, go check your devices. Make sure they're all working. As I walk back towards the driver's compartment, I'm checking the seats. I give them a little pull, make sure they're secure. I'm checking the seat brackets. Make sure they seem secure to the bus floor. I'm checking for trash, any sharp objects, any damage to my seats. This is a requirement, my friends, on the passenger compartment. And I keep going. And of course, I got my modesty panels. And that completes the inspection
of the passenger compartment. Let's move on. Okay, for this next section, grab your gloves, grab your tire buddy, and go beat up somebody. No. For this next section, we're doing walk arounds. And if you're familiar with that term, is when we go outside, do the inspection of everything, the body, lights, turn signals, etc., tires, all that good stuff. So what I do on my first walk around, I activate my left turn signal, my headlights, my amber lights, and clearance lights, or also known as marker lights. So here we go. The best way to start this inspection is right in front of the bus. You check your mirror brackets, your mirrors, make sure they're all clean, free of any cracks. You got your amber lights, which are activated. Your clearance lights are activated. It is labeled school bus. Amber lights are the proper color. Windshield is clean, free of any cracks. The seals are not loose. These are also kick-out windows in case of emergencies. You check your wipers. Make sure they're not loose, cracked. The front body of the bus, no damage. The number of the bus. Both headlights, make sure they're operating. My left turn signal's on. The bumper, make sure it's secure in place. And then I come to this section. Again, check the mirror brackets, make sure they're secure to the body of the bus. My three mirrors, they're all clean, free of any damage or cracks. Then from this point, because I do have another bus right by me, I check as much as I can see to the back of the bus. Clearance lights are operating. Marker lights are operating. And there is also side blinkers on the other side, on the right side, which are working simultaneously with my left turn signal that I can see on my cross view mirror. As much as I can see, my windows are clean, free of any cracks, and there's no visible damage to the body of the bus. Electrical panel secure in place. Reflective decal secure in place. Now I come to this section. Bus once labeled, light system secure. Tire section. Check this guard. It's good in place, not loose, cracked. Mud guard, secure in place. Now I will do our tire sweep to check for nails or rocks. Check the tire, the whole tire, make sure there's no bulges or cracks on it. It looks properly inflated. Check the tread on the front axle tires, must be no less than 4/32 of an inch in all major grooves of this tire. The rim has no rust, cracks, illegal welding, or dents. Our lug nuts are tight and visible with her caps on, and the stem is secure in place with a cap. Keep walking to this section. I do have a cargo door in place, which is secure. Another cargo door in place, which is secure. Reflective the decal in place. District logo properly labeled. California logo number properly labeled. Another cargo door secure in place. Now I come to the emergency exit. So I'm gonna have my buddy, my cell phone man, record me for this next section. All right, I'm back. So on this bus, I do point that I do have two emergency exits, one labeled up here, and that's for that window. Operations are inside. I did check that and it works. It's labeled emergency exit up here again. There's an arrow pointing up, prompting me to push this lever, open the door all the way out. But now, a requirement, if it's in there, you gotta make sure the locking bracket works. Then you check the whole system on the side door, you check the seal, make sure it's not cracked or loose. This emergency exit is up to standard, it's operating properly. From this point, I check again my windows, they're all clean, free of any cracks. I don't see any visible damage to the body of the bus. Light system secure in place, stop arm secure to the bus's body. I come to the second tire section. Side guard's good, muff flap's good, and I do have a visual on my drive shaft guard. It's there. I can't see my inner tire, so I'm gonna tap. It sounds inflated to me. Now I will do a tire sweep, check for any nails or rocks on both tires, and between the tire for anything stuck. Anything stuck in there can create friction, heat, eventually blowing up your tires. Check the thread, must be no less than 2/32 of an inch in all major grooves of both tires. And that's good on the rear axle. The front tire has no bulges or cracks. It looks properly inflated. The rim has no rust, cracks, illegal welding, or dents. The stems are secure with their caps. Inner stem secure with the cap. And I check all lug nuts, and they're tight with their caps on. And the hub nuts, well, I don't have access to them, but they got a cap on. But if I was able to do a bus with this style, where I can check all these lug nuts and hub nuts, I will also check for rust lines indicating they're coming out loose. Rust lines do indicate they may be coming out loose. I keep going to the back, check every panel, make sure it's secure in place, reflect the decal in place, and on the back over here, all clearance lights are operating properly. My amber lights are operating properly, and they're the right color. It is labeled school bus. It is labeled emergency exit. Rear windows clean and free of any cracks. There's an arrow pointing to the left. I follow the instructions, open the emergency exit. I check the seals, they're good. Close it, this emergency exit's good. My left turn signal's on, park lights are on. It is labeled bus one. There's no license plate because it's a new bus, but I will check to make sure that license plate was secure and that the license plate light operates properly. Reflect the decal in place. Stop when red light flashes properly labeled. Reflect the decal in place. My bumper secure to the bus and the exhaust secure. It is flush with the bumper. I'm not required to check my engine components. We have mechanics for that, but I do check on the bottom for any leaks. And there's no leaks. So let me explain what I'll do next. I will do the same inspection I did on that side, because I am on time for this video, that I did. I will do the same thing on this side. Inspect everything the same. Tires, mirrors, windows, cargo doors, everything the same. So this is the setup for the first walk around. So let's move on. Okay, so now I set up my bus for my second walk around. On the second walk around, I activated my red lights, right turn signal, and high beams. And of course, brake lights. So it's very simple. I check that my red lights are operating properly and they're the right color. My right turn signal's on, my high beams are on. I go to the back, so if you wanna follow me, let's go, go, go. My right turn signal on the sides are good, and they're working simultaneously. And how do I know that? Because I know my bus. The right turn signal is good. And on the rear, the right turn signal is working simultaneously with the side blinkers. My red lights are operating properly and they're the right color. And my brake lights are on. they are brighter because I use my tire buddy over there in the front to activate my brake lights. So we're gonna move on. Again, for the second walk around was red lights, right turn signal, high beams, and what else? Do you guys remember? Okay, so it's right, bright, red, brakes. Remember that. It's pretty cool to remember that. Right, bright, red, brakes. Let's move on. Okay, on this last walk around, I activated my hazard lights. And if you can follow me, please. I check my hazard lights on the side and on the front side, and they're operating right. My hazard lights on the rear are operating correctly. My backup lights are operating correctly. And if your bus is equipped with a strobe light, you will also inspect the strobe light to make sure it works. One last thing that I'm gonna activate is my stop arm to make sure that it's operating correctly. Let's move on. And the last thing that I do, everybody has a different sequence on how to do things, but this is the way I do this. I check my stop arm. It's very important to make sure that you give it actually a little, don't pull, just make sure that it's secure in place to the body of the bus, that the lights are operating properly on the front, and that the lights on the rear are operating properly. Everything's legible and clean. This is a very important sign, my friends. Even though the truth is that a lot of people out there don't respect our stop arm, but we are doing our job. Make sure that everything works during your pre-trip inspection. So with that, we're gonna go into now the air brakes, so stay tuned. All right, as I promised, we were gonna cover the air brake section. So I'm not using the same bus that I use for the pre-trip inspection outside, all that other good stuff. So I'm gonna do what's required, which is to test the governor cut in, the governor cut out, static test, the applied test, low warning devices, and then check my brakes for adjustments and to make sure that they are working mechanically properly. All right. So the first thing I'll do is make sure that my bus is secure with the park brake applied. Turn the ignition on. Accessories, the low warnings come on. They must go off. Very important for the low warning lights to go off. They did is turn on the bus. This is one of those low starter buses. I'll see my gauges, make sure they go up in pressure, both needles right here for the primary and secondary. This is my primary and secondary. And they are at cutoff pressure. So the first test I'll do is to test the governor cut in. The governor must cut in and no less than 85 PSI. So to find the true governor cut in, I'm just gonna depress my service brake pedal enough to lose about 5 pounds. So my readings are now at 125. I'm going down to 120. I'm gonna wait between 8 and 10 seconds to see the needles rise. If there's no movement, if they don't rise, then the governor is not cutting in at 120. This is the right way to find the true governor cut in. That's when the governor says, hey, air compressor, I need air in my tanks. Very simple. All right, 10 seconds pass by. Let's repeat the process again. We're gonna go down to 115 PSI. And again, the same thing, wait. Right, so we're still waiting. 1009, 1010. All right, let's pump it down to 110 PSI.
again, I'm counting for 10 seconds. You could do it, you could do a silent count, or you can be loud like me. 1004, 1005, 1006, 1007, 1008, 1009, and 1010. And the needle is rising. The needle is moving up. So the true governor cutting on this bus is at 110 PSI. Now let's test the governor cutout. Must cut out no more than 130. So exactly where this gauge needle stopped rising, that's gonna be the true governor cutout. All right, I heard the quick release valve. That's a good way to do it, but I want you to check your gauges. So there you stop at 125 PSI. That is the true governor cutout. That's the way to test your air brake system. For the true governor cut in, the true governor cut out. Must be cutting no less than 85, must cut out no more than 130. The next section is to do the static test. Static test is very simple. Okay, check this out. I'm moving, now I'm static. This is static, I'm not moving other than my mouth. Okay, that's what static means. So first, of course I wanna make sure my part brake supplied. I am not stepping on no pedals, though my pedals are in there. Turn the bus off. This system's digital. So I need to have the ignition back only. So ignition goes on, not the bus, only the ignition. Check those warning lights again. Then make sure they go off. Well, they did. Wait for the gauges to set and stabilize. And at this point, time myself for 1 minute. During the static test, sorry for that finger. During the static test, the system's allowed to lose up to 2 PSI in 1 minute. Any observable movement of these gauge needles, it's a possible air leak. Any observable movement. And if there is an air leak during this test, the air leak may be coming from the treadle valve right below the service brake pedal, airlines on the applied side of the system, on the supply side of the system, air tanks, one-way check valves, air dryer, or any loose fittings in those components. So during the static test, if there's movement, if these needles start going up, they're going up, okay, we got movement, then that may indicate you have an air leak. All right, so a minute's up, there is no movement of these gauge needles. They stay where they're at. This is the most accurate one right here, the primary system gauge. So the static test is good. Next test is the applied test. What I do, I make a full service brake application, hold it, take note of how much pressure it took, so it went down from 125 to 120. Take note of that every day. And if for any reason I start noticing that it takes more pressure day by day, that may indicate my brakes are coming out of adjustment. Now, I release my park brake. Very simple, I just push that knob, that releases the park brake system. So I just applied air into the spring chambers. So air has been applied into the spring chambers, the brake chambers, air is applied everywhere. During the applied test, I'm allowed to lose no more than 3 PSI in 1 minute. Any observable movement of the gauge needles is a possible air leak. And if there's an air leak during this test, the air leak may be coming from the treadle valve, airlines on the applied side of the system, front brake chambers, rear brake chambers, spring brake chambers, or any loose fittings in those components. So, again, for all testing purposes, I'm checking for 1 whole minute. It's very important that you check for 1 whole minute. But since I'm on time on this, I'm trying to get this under the required time because I'm supposed to be showing you guys everything. I'm gonna say a minute's up. There is no movement of the gauge needles. Apply test is good. So before I continue, the safe thing to do is apply the park brake. Now I can ease off the service brake gently because I know it's hard and you get tired of pressing that pedal. Now I'm testing my low warning devices. Both gotta be audible and visible, and they must activate at the instrument panel. On this particular bus, they're gonna come out right here. So let's exactly check where the low warning device activates. Those devices must activate no less than 60 PSI and must stay on at all pressures under 60. Okay, I'm at the 75 mark right now. Let's see. The 65, they came on, so that's a good test. Both lower warnings came on at 65 for the primary and secondary. All right, turn the bus back on. Now I am going to allow the system on both primary and secondary sides to build pressure back to 100 psi. All right, both gauges are above 100 psi and building up towards cutout. So what I'm gonna do next, I am gonna put the bus in gear, release the park brake, and I will go forward and make three stops, twice applying the service brakes, once applying the park brake. This is what I also call the dead throttle rolls forward. I'm just applying the service brakes, covering my service brakes, and bringing the bus to a complete stop. So what I'm checking there is that the brakes work right. At the same time, I'm checking for any pull on the steering wheel. When I come to a complete stop, if I feel pull either to the right or to the left, that may indicate that my front axle brakes may be coming out of adjustment. And then I'll do one more test. So it's two going forward, bringing the bus to a complete stop with the service brakes, once going forward, bringing the bus to a complete stop, applying the park brake to test the rear brakes, to test that the rear brakes are in good adjustments. So you just take note of how much distance it takes for the bus to stop. After that, I'll leave the bus in gear like I do have right now with the park brake system applied. Then I will throttle the system. Watch my RPMs. I will throttle the system as I'm doing now to about, I'm gonna say almost 11 to 1200 RPMs. So I'm using engine power to test that the park brake system holds the bus in place, which in this case it did. So that concludes, let me secure the bus, that concludes the dual air system test, or the dual air brake system test. And it's very simple to do if you practice every day. It is very simple to do. Remember, governor cut in must be at no less than 85 psi. Governor cut out must be at no more than 130. And your static, you're allowed to lose no more than 2 psi in 1 minute. On the applied, you're allowed to lose no more than 3 psi in 1 minute. The load warning devices must activate at no less than 60 psi. And stay on at all pressures under 60. And you check your brakes for adjustments, as I mentioned. You check your brakes to make sure they're working right. And if you have the chance, split the system. That helps a lot. So, the whole purpose of splitting the system, draining each tank separately, is to check your double check valve, your low warning. You're checking your double check valve to make sure that it seals the system that's leaking air. You also check your low warning to see exactly where it activates on each side. You drain each system all the way down to zero, and you test each system by pulling forward, applying your service brakes pedal like you normally do. So if when you go to CHP and they ask you what happens if you lose all the air on one side of the system, in reality, don't panic, nothing happens. You're able to pull to the side at the same location, applying your brakes like you regularly do, because you still have, applying your brakes like you always do, because you still have another side of the system. This is a dual air brake system, dual, dos, two. So don't panic, you will always have braking power. If you lose all the air from your primary and secondary system, you still will be able to stop at least once. You notice your gauge is going down, your low end warnings have activated. Look for a safe spot as soon as possible, pull over, because eventually this little friend right here will pop out and activate, and that bus will lock and you will not be able to move it. So once in a while, it's good to drain the system. If you don't know how, ask your trainer. And if you don't have a trainer, call superintendent of schools. They have awesome trainers there too. So thank you. I hope you enjoy.